to the women's show. October is the Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And rightly so, because when you look at the statistics within Uganda, breast cancer is the second most common type of cancer. I hope I am correct on that. And so today we sit down to have a conversation around breast cancer awareness and understanding the intricate, you know, conversations people should be having around breast cancer. And the statistics from Uganda Women's Cancer Support Organization says over 70% of breast cancer patients in the region, that's the East African region, usually show up with last stage cancer. So that's quite problematic when we think about breast cancer. But joining me today, there are women who, some are breast cancer survivors, some are working in the field, and they have first-hand knowledge or lived experiences of what breast cancer really is and why we should care. They'll take turns to introduce themselves. Ladies, welcome to this show. It's a women's show where we just talk all things women. And today particularly, I want you to help me understand, you know, the conversation around breast cancer. I love that we all have the pink ribbons. That's a sign for breast cancer. But I'll begin from that end. You help us introduce yourself, who you are, the work you do, so that we can begin this conversation.
Thank you very much, my dear. I'm so glad to be on this platform. And my name's Juliet Namudu. I work with the Medical Concierge Group, which is known as Rocket Health. Mm. I am a breast cancer awareness champion. I love talking about women and women issues. And as Rocket Health, in this month of October, we have taken initiative to offer certain discounts to the women out there, yeah, to be able to access these services nearer to them.
Yeah.
We are doing a breast cancer screening test for every woman out there, in addition to so many other tests for the wellness of a woman, which will be open until the 31st of October.
That's nice.
All you need to do is just dial *280#, and you'll be able to access a doctor, and we'll come to you to do these tests.
Welcome to the show, Namudu.
Thank you very much.
And I'm glad that you actually put that out there so people know what to do. Please go get yourself tested. Thanks.
I'm so humbled to be a part of this conversation. My name is Namato Habisaj. I'm a doctor working with the Medical Concierge Group, known as the Rocket Health. I'm so passionate about reproductive health, and I'm so glad to be here. Thank you so much.
Welcome to the show, my dear.
Hello, our viewers. I'm very, very happy to be here. My name is Dr. Catherine Bira Promise. I'm not a medical doctor. I am a PhD holder in International Development Studies. And today I'm here as the public relations officer and advocacy in charge of the board of the Uganda Women's Cancer Support Organization. It's an organization founded by women survivors of various kinds of cancer. We give psychosocial support and other kinds of help to people who are currently going through cancer. And this month, in October, we are reaching out to corporate institutions, giving free breast cancer awareness sessions, and ultimately to bring it all in. We are demonstrating one way of prevention by organizing a public Zumba. We are going to have a public dance workout on the 4th of November at the MTN Arena from 6 to 9 p.m. We shall also have free screening services there for cervical cancer, breast cancer, and hopefully prostate cancer. So everybody is welcome. Participation is 20,000. I will give you a kit with a message, early detection saves lives. And I hope that everybody can come and show solidarity to people who are battling cancer right now. Give them courage in memory and honor of their loved ones who have passed on to breast cancer. And also to raise awareness and assist the advocacy efforts, because it's a responsibility for each and every one of us to improve cancer care in this country. It is an act of self-preservation.
Yes.
Thank
Welcome
you.
Welcome to the show, Dr.
Thank Thanks you very much.
And last but not certainly least.
Thank you. Hello, viewers. My name is Caroline Akello. I am a member of the Women's Cancer Support Organization. And I am currently still on treatment for breast cancer. It's been 5 years. But I also do voluntary counseling at the Cancer Institute. And then we do outreaches. We visit patients in their homes to provide support. And because most patients prefer to speak to those who have gone through the experience. So that's what we do. Yeah. And I'm so happy to be in the show.
Welcome. And I love the brevity of your story, because it's hard to talk while fighting a lot of times. Okay. But I am glad that even in the middle of the fight, you have a voice. So it's quite encouraging. It's a first lesson even before we dive into. But let me bring back to you, Namudu. Exactly, on understanding what breast cancer really is. You know, a lot of people think of if I have a lump in my breast, perhaps I have breast cancer. What is the nitty gritty around breast cancer? What really is it?
Okay, I'm not a medical personnel, so I will allow doctor to answer the nitty gritties of that. But as a person who has done a self-test, there are certain self-test breast examinations that can be done where they ask you to check for any lumps, like lumps, I would say hardenings in the breast. It's an indication of breast cancer, but I think that can be confirmed through a mammogram test after that. Mm-hmm. But the doctors are the ones to refer to you, and it's encouraging that the women should be able to test themselves first through the different steps that can be taken before they take the mammogram test in this day and age. But allow the doctor that I came with to get into the nitty-gritties of those breast cancer.
And maybe also help us understand mammography, because it's a big word. So in understanding it, we begin to have this conversation.
Okay. Yeah. So mammogram is like an X-ray of the breast, basically that. So it shows that all part of the breast, the lobules, how are the ducts, how is the connective tissue in details. So it's basically an X-ray of the breast.
And how often should I, reach out to do that?
So it's the confirmatory test for breast cancer. So after you're doing a self-check examination, we refer you to a doctor to also do it. After the doctor confirming that there's probably a mass or a lump or some discharge or any other abnormality, maybe changes in the skin or dimpling, wrinkling, then the doctor requests for the mammogram, which confirms if it's breast cancer or some other normal lumps, because it's not basically breast cancer that causes lumps in the breast, but some other diseases like the fibrocystic breast disease. So after confirming, we can now stage, is it stage 1, stage 2, is it stage 3 or 4, and then give you the appropriate treatment.
That's interesting, because that means then self-examination is very important.
It's very important.
And it took this conversation for me to stand in my mirror and say, you know what, begin. I didn't know what I was doing, but then I was like, if I feel anything, then I will go to the show knowing I am dying. But what's the awareness around this self-examination? And hear me out. If we have October to think about these things, how often do people have this conversation and say, you know what, let me check? Or do we, go through life imagining that the worst may not certainly happen to us? Or if it happens, then we rush to get help only to find out we are a little bit too late. How often are people taught how to self-examine?
Okay, so we normally recommend it to be done every menstrual cycle. It's better because of the hormonal changes. After your periods, you can do it every month. And in case you find any abnormality, that's when we seek for further medical attention.
Well, that's interesting. And let me bring you in this conversation. Yeah. You know how we are a carb eating, and as I was reading around and I was wondering, does diet have anything to do with, breast cancer and it showing up in our bodies?
Yeah, thank you. I would like first to supplement to what they have said. One thing I forgot to say when I was introducing myself is I'm a 7-year survivor of breast cancer myself. As diagnosed immediately after completing my PhD. And I'm speaking from experience. And just to mention, doctor highlighted some of the possible signs and symptoms. We just have to mention and be very, very clear that not every abnormality is a cancer.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that is one of the biggest challenges we have. We see an abnormality, the disease is so highly stigmatized, everybody imagines the worst, fears, refuses to expose it to anyone, and that is part of the reason we have over 80% actually of our breast cancer patients are presenting in stage 3 and stage 4, when treatment is much more difficult. It's the fear. The fear. And in our minds, the imagination that this is a death sentence. Honestly, cancer is no longer, breast cancer especially, is no longer a death sentence. In the Western world, over 90% of people who experience it survive way beyond 5 years after being diagnosed. And in India, it's about 66%. In Uganda, about 50%.
Well, that's nice.
South Africa, yeah. But it's nice, given that 80% are diagnosed in late stage presentation. That is nice that we have at least 50% survival rate. But imagine if we were diagnosed much earlier, how much more we would have in terms of survivability. But of course, on the downside, when I say 50%, it means 1 in 2 women who gets it will die. Yeah, so it's important. So for the signs, we encourage, yes, of course, that self-examination. But even culturally, I just shared recently on a forum, and a friend of mine told me, meat is weird. Like, how do I touch my breasts? Like, touching myself. So she's like, this is, it's weird. It's difficult. Yeah. And I think these are the conversations we need to have. You know? But also to mention the men. People also tell you that their lumps, abnormalities were detected by their partners.
Oh, that's so interesting.
They should not just focus on only the other things. But I mean, if you notice that there is an abnormality,
the other things are important.
The other things are important, but it's also good to know your territory and how it looks and detect if there is any invasion. So it's very, very important that anyone who has access to the breast, but first and foremost, we women, our breasts, we have them with us all the time. So regardless of how weird it feels, it will save your life if you're able to detect. And she talked about a mammography, and I'm sure that she will bear with me that we've had experiences of many people who have been through, who actually either got misdiagnosed or the machinery was not really accurate. It helps to show that there is something, but sometimes to be able to classify that this is a benign cyst that's completely innocent and this one is a malignant one, sometimes it is not that accurate. So we encourage people to pursue, you know, the doctors know a biopsy, where like cells can be removed to get like real conclusion. Because in my case, I was told by 4 different doctors, 3 had done scans and 1 had done a mammography. And they all showed that my cyst didn't look suspicious. But because I have an aunt who passed away because of breast cancer, my antenna was way up there. Yeah. And I kept saying, they are saying it's innocent, but why should it be in my body?
Yeah.
Like, why doesn't anyone tell me the cause of the lump? Why should I be comfortable with a lump that has just appeared? So I insisted and pursued the lumpectomy. They removed the lump. And it is only after that actually. Okay. Because even when they put a needle and removed cells, the test proved inconclusive. Mm-hmm. So it was after that that they removed the lump that it was finally caught, and luckily mine was caught at its earliest stage. So if I hadn't had maybe that traumatic experience of losing a person very dear to me, maybe I wouldn't have been as proactive. Then diet, you asked about diet. It is indeed, breast cancer is classified as a lifestyle illness, environmental factors, sedentary lifestyles. But that is not to say that those of us who get it because we are the careless ones, you know. I used to sit in my former office. I used to drink, you know, a flask of green tea every day. I used to eat my salad. I was like the health freak everybody knew. And when the news came that I had breast cancer, everyone was like, Catherine, really? Like, of all people, no, this can't be, But it happens. There, we have lots of things that expose us, you know. Environmental issues, the food we are eating in a restaurant out there, people spraying, you know, fresh vegetables with all sorts of pesticides, and we are eating these things.
And so it might be a salad, but it can easily kill you.
Exactly. Exactly. So we are looking at the person who is eating KFC and we are pointing fingers at them, and we are here eating like all this nice cucumber, but it is even maybe more exactly. So that is a problem, but I need to emphasize this. I believe that had I not been living that kind of lifestyle, maybe the cancer would have eaten me up faster. So my body fought. So it's important that we help our bodies to fight. Regardless, yes, healthy people are getting it, but healthy people have higher chances of survival than those who have already comorbidities resulting also maybe from a lifestyle. So there, it's important we exercise, it's important we eat healthy, it's important we take enough rest, it's important we break free from negativity and things like that. It does help in the fight, because the fight against cancer is not just a physical fight, it's a spiritual fight, it's an emotional fight. So yeah.
So your whole well-being has to be in check.
Exactly.
Unfortunately for me, these conversations take me into a Pandora box. It's like, am I walking enough? Am I doing enough? Did I eat carbs this week? Am I on alkaline? So in as much as you want to avoid negativity, you go into this cycle of, I don't want to die so young. But you said something that I want to pick up on the fact that there was someone within your family that had cancer. And I personally have had a cancer death in our family. And when you spoke about fear, it actually reminded me of the fact that how scared they were. And they were so scared they didn't look for solutions. And by the time they went, I think the first, because I was working in healthcare at that time, when I read the report, I saw last stage carcinoma and I knew that was a death sentence almost, because we had done chemotherapy, we had then gone on second line chemotherapy, and it wasn't really working. She had done radiation and she had gotten, you know, the surgeries for both the breasts, and somehow we just were in a cycle. So by the time they put her on palliative, it was, you had to read the report for yourself to understand it. And unfortunately, not everybody can know what the report says apart from the patient. But when you speak about fear, what then can we do, especially because these experiences are within our families, what then can we do differently?
Well, I think a lot of what you're doing right now, there is a study that was done at the Uganda Cancer Institute, and 78% of the patients said that their number one need was to talk to a survivor.
That's nice.
Because people believe that if you're diagnosed, you're finished.
True. Yeah.
And so even the refusal to go to a health center is like, why am I wasting time? They are going to, it's going to be expensive. People are going to shun me, because people shun, by the way. The stigma, people shun, you lose friends. People think you're going to start asking them for money, I don't know, for treatment. So they stop taking your calls and stuff like that.
And cancer medicine is expensive.
Yes.
Can I say something about
please,
that?
Please,
Okay. When it comes to cancer treatment, there is free chemotherapy
yes.
at the Uganda Cancer Institute. Mm. There is affordable radiotherapy at the Uganda Cancer Institute. There is actually both private and general treatment. Private patients pay at least 90,000 shillings for every visit. Okay. General patients have free blood tests for CBCs nice. And blood chemistry mm. for every visit. Mm. And chemotherapy is free. Consultation is free for general patients. So it's actually affordable. The only challenge we have is we just have one center that provides the care. Yeah. So it's overwhelmed and access. People coming from all over to this place presents a lot of challenges. Mm. But actually, it's possible to get treatment.
So in any case, do we then need to... Because I'm worried of privatizing such an industry because then people are going to milk money out of it. Mm. I remember buying a medicine called Kaichil, and I speak from this because I've ever taken care of a medicine called Kaichil, and it was extremely expensive. Mm-hmm. That we reached a point where, because you have a little bit of people outside of this country, so if they can get it at a cheaper rate and bring it within the country, that would have been helpful. And for some reason, I felt like because of that monopoly of services, mm-hmm. somehow you've got to pay an extra to get the extra care mm-hmm. to get to the people that you want to get to. So if we privatized mm-hmm. this care, would it make it better?
Okay, the reality about cancer treatment is when it comes to taking care of a cancer patient, first of all, like she said earlier, you do a mammogram. Yes, I did a mammogram. It was highly suspicious, not conclusive. I did a fine needle aspiration. That is a fine needle aspiration biopsy. Mm-hmm. It was highly suspicious, not conclusive. So when I reached the Uganda Cancer, I did all that outside. But when I reached the Uganda mm-hmm. Cancer Institute, I had to do another biopsy. Because at the Cancer Institute, you are not going to be treated unless they have confirmed that you really have the cancer.
Interesting.
Now, once you have been tested and it's positive to cancer, there is what they call a tumor board, a group of doctors that will sit comprising of a specialist of breast, a surgeon, a radiographer. Mm. They will sit, look at all the results, then they will make a decision on what kind of treatment you should do. Before that treatment is done, you have to test whether all your organs are functioning well. Is your liver okay? Is all
kidney,
those things?
Everything.
Yes, have to be. The heart, is it working well? Mm. So that is the kind of care someone should get. Mm. So if someone goes private, will they get that? And you cannot pick one doctor, sit him there, and have them make all the decisions because it's a complex disease. So that is it about cancer. Now, remember, chemotherapy is a very expensive treatment. Mm. So for you to get quality chemotherapy, Uganda Cancer Institute can afford it because they have the support of the government.
Yeah. Mm.
They're working with the American Cancer Society and other organizations to bring in the right treatment. Mm. If you go private, you might get the worst quality of treatment.
Yes. Mm.
So that is cancer.
Because there is an aspect of business when it comes to private.
And then imaging alone is another thing.
Mm-hmm.
The imaging department, they have CT scans, they have, and then radiotherapy. It's only in Cancer Institute. So where are you going to get radiotherapy treatment if you go private?
I hear you.
Yeah. Mm. So that is a challenge we have.
And I love the broadness of it because then that means at least there is, you know, a whole,
range
of services. A whole service sector that has come together to make sure this thing works. I also know they also have a children's center, a bit inside there.
Mm-hmm.
And I was amazed by the work that they do for the children and also their survival rates.
Mm-hmm.
Like the fighting chance for the children is way up there. I was quite impressed with that. But let me bring you in this Namodo. Especially because she said it, and I don't know why I keep skipping it. The fact that you're, I don't know, are you more likely to get breast cancer if someone in your family has it? Is it something that's dealt with genes or what?
This is one of the things that I wanted to discuss about, the high risk factors of a breast cancer patient. I think one of them is to trace, should we say, the mother's side, if you have had someone survive or had breast cancer. Same way for prostate, you're more at risk of getting it. That's why you need to be more cautious take more initiative in finding out any changes in your breast, because you're more at risk than any other ordinary person, based on also other factors like health, diet, lifestyle. But if you have lost someone or someone who has survived the cancer, you're more at risk. Isn't it, doctor?
Well, that's good. It's quite interesting and quite scary, because at least I know two people, like from my maternal side, that did have cancer and they did die. But then the narrative for me is, if it's on my maternal side and then there is a male person in our family, are they equally at risk of getting that cancer?
Yes, they are. Interesting. The risk factors, like, there are more in females compared to the men. Men too can get breast cancer, but the females are at a high risk.
It's quite shocking.
Yeah. I would also like to add, like they have said, when you have a history in the family, you know, there are like two classes of factors. There are those you cannot control, you know, like now the genes. I mean, it's in the family, we are more predisposed. Then there are those other factors that you can control for the exercise, the diet, lifestyle, and all that. Aging, like if older people are more susceptible, those things we may not control for them. But I need also to highlight, because I'm seeing you're asking, oh, we've had two people, I'm scared. You know, you need not be, because the data shows that actually the majority of patients of breast cancer are not from this group. They are not from people who have the history in their families. They are the other people who are getting it without the known history are much more. So these are predisposing factors. They may increase your risk. You need to be alert. You need to be aware of them. And maybe they can help you explain why, if you're not the person who fits the profile, you may get it. But it's important to know that people outside of this, the majority of the patients are not in this group. So it's important for us to note that.
Now, talking about the fear that you have, you talked about something about us as individuals living our lives thinking it will never get this disease. Even me, that was the thing. I was diagnosed, I was just 30, and it never occurred to me in my life it would ever happen. So for me, I think, you remember when HIV came into our lives as people? We were all out there reaching out to schools. Everyone knows about HIV. Even if you talk to someone in primary three, they can tell you what HIV is. And you know, cancer has been here this long, and it's not something that we talk about openly.
I noticed.
So for me, I believe if for some reason, if we as Ugandans, I can't say the whole world, because I don't know how people do things in other countries. If Ugandans can accept and say, there is this problem, and we are not running away from it, because instead of reducing it, it's increasing. Can we start to tell our children? Can we go to the schools and tell our children that there is this problem?
Awareness.
Yes. Let them grow up knowing that it's there and it's a possibility. And if they saw someone suffer from it, it shouldn't come as a surprise.
We can
do that. And then as adults, we have different platforms. Can we talk about the things normally? The challenge is we feel like, oh my goodness, it's cancer. No.
And I noticed that, because every other time a conversation around cancer has come, it has come with a drive. There's a drive for someone, and that is when now we are really actually talking about it. Like the worst of society coming together has been to save someone who is dying of maybe this kind of cancer, or they are struggling with this. And the mainstream is void of these conversations until it's October. And then we are like, oh, there is an aha moment. So let's raise awareness. So how do we have, you know how we had flyers on HIV, what it is, how you can get it, there was an ABC. How do we have consumable education around breast cancer? And maybe I'll give that to you, because you're the champion around there on breast cancer, so that these conversations don't end on a particular month, don't end on a drive. And even on the drive, people don't really have the conversation. They're actually just looking for money to be able to help this person. How do we move into those conversations?
Thank you.
as she highlighted, it's a continuous effort. Like, it has to start with you. You have to continuously make people aware that the condition is there, how you can prevent it. The numbers of people who have gotten, who are at risk and have had it in their maternal line has reduced because people are aware and they are more cautious. So if we have this conversation, not only in October, but even in January, February, throughout the year, we need to be whatever platform you are as a woman, be able to talk about it, even with the young ladies, be able to talk about it so that people know that it's actually, when we talk about it more and make people aware of how they can identify, we'll have less people coming at that. And also support system, be the support system for someone. Don't make the person feel so bad. Cancer, it's the end of life. That's how it used to be for HIV. Yes. But now people have hope. Be the hope to the other woman or man that is in your society, in whatever capacity you're in. I think that's the first step in every.
And I think, I don't remember when, it must have been in high school that I learned the self-examination method. And it just, I think it took doctors who came and did the, that training. It must have been another October sometime.
Yes, usually.
Yes, but Dr. Namatev, let's talk about health checkup. One thing that I have noticed as Ugandans is you would rather first fall sick before you show up in that hospital.
Curative.
And and you're like, okay, now this malaria has come, let me go. There is just something that I'm not understanding. I'm very scared. Let me get into the hospital. But how do we promote a habit of health checkups so that we do not wait for doomsday to show up? You're like, okay, now I need all the specialists to gather. I'm sick. But to have a continuous lifestyle of going into, you know, at the beginning of the year, check yourself, in the middle of the year, walking, how do we have that happen?
Okay, I'm going to talk this as we, as Roketo, we always, every month, we always put in packages. Now, like for this month, as she discussed before, for women, to encourage them that you do not need to first maybe feel feverish or maybe first have a headache for you to do a general body checkup. You can do it depending on you, maybe how you afford, or maybe your organization, because some organization do it for their staff. So it is up to you as a person to always remind yourself that I really need this, maybe twice a month, sorry, twice a year, or maybe three times a year. Like, depending on you as a person, but we as Rocket Health, we always encourage people every month to do a general body checkup.
And I ask that because when you spoke about last stage, third stage, and fourth stage, and people showing up then, I wondered what the numbers were for first stage and second stage, or even for people that just have benigns and decide to actually pursue maybe surgery or then have the biopsies happen. How are the numbers? Have the numbers increased? Are the numbers stable? Are people actually now being more proactive when it comes to their personal health? That is why I come from that point. Yeah.
Well, first we have to mention that we have certain challenges already with data in this country. Our health statistics are very, very much lacking. And I would appeal really that from an advocacy perspective, this is an area where we need as a country to invest. Because even these statistics that we are giving, you know, people will tell you they're getting the information from Uganda Cancer Institute. It's much more reliable because that's the, like, the center. But even these numbers, statistics got from the Kampala Cancer Registry, which is basically cancer, and I think Chadondo. So there's a lot more in all the regional referral hospitals, in all the lower level health centers, a lot that we are not gathering. And so even when they talk about this 70 to 80%, it is really very centralized and in a small population, meaning that we actually may have lots and lots and lots more who are dying at home. And all that. So if we say 80 to 90% are late stage diagnosis, it means only 20% are earlier stage, you know, diagnosis. So really data is very, very important. But also to say that generally, I mean, our health system is very much under strain. In the lower level health centers, I mean, how many health workers even know how to do a breast exam?
Yes.
That a woman from my village in, I don't know, Rengiho village in Chisinga sub-county is going to go to a health center closest to her and have a health worker be able to do this. So we have still have a lot of work to do. We have come a long way. We have come a long way. Those who access treatment have come a long way. They know, we know how much Uganda Cancer Institute is doing, how much it has transformed. But getting down to that level of the grassroots, I read a report that said in one of the regional referral hospitals, 48% of the patients who are diagnosed were categorized among the extremely poor.
Oh.
And that is one thing which I needed to also add on in addition to what my colleague here said. The treatment is free and all that. But we exist as Uganda Women's Cancer Support Organization partly because the rate at which people abandon treatment is also high. Because when somebody has come from Gulu, comes to Kampala, they have no accommodation. They have no food. Once they get one round of chemotherapy and it is working them, they're like, why should this drug kill me? I'd rather go back home where I have food. So we need to think beyond just the medical intervention, but also the sociological and socioeconomic aspects that make adherence to the treatment that is recommended by the medical doctors difficult. So those are all challenges we have as a country, and that's why the civil society really needs to be supported to bring out this information, to reach people in the lower level, the grassroots, maybe like through the village health teams, to teach people in the members of village health teams how to do breast self-examination. So they are the first point of contact for that rural woman before she reaches the health center three at the sub-county level. So yeah, those are issues we need to really highlight. It's good that everybody plays their part. The Rocket Health, they make the packages, they make the offer for people who can reach them. But it's important for equity and social justice that we know that not all of us have the same equality of opportunity, even to reach the free service that is being given at UCI.
And that was my concern, because recently in the news, Butabika has been with an overwhelm. And they're like, you know what? We need to disseminate. Every government referral needs to have a section where mental health is being actually, you know, taken care of. And that was my concern. Then how do we, and I'm very worried with the, with how that will translate when it comes to having a radiologist, an oncologist, and all these other teams sit to examine and diagnose you before they put you on radiotherapy or chemotherapy. How do we then have, in the other referrals or in the health center fours, people that have this knowledge be at those points to help reduce, especially in building around equity, to help reduce, you know, the influx that comes into, you know, Uganda Cancer Institute to just get the service? Because perhaps that is where the disconnect also is in access and in receiving this treatment. I don't know.
I first of all, I want to say that hope is not lost, because as a Uganda Cancer Institute, it's one of Uganda Cancer Institute is actually the what government is using to do something about cancer in the country. And recently, I think Herbert can agree with me that we had a breast health conference, and they are doing something about coming up with how to manage breast cancer, I mean breast health in Uganda, not just the cancer but the
breast
whole thing. And one of the things that came out is that there is a very, very high need to train health workers, because our health workers are not trained in oncology, they are not specialists with the breasts. And that is one of the biggest challenges. And we agreed in that conference that we need to get to the village health team. So something is being done about that. Then also, as the Uganda Cancer Institute and as the Ugandan government, they are building regional centers for cancer.
Nice.
Oh,
that's
currently,
nice.
What we have, what we know is the Gulu Center is under construction and it's underway. The one for Eastern Region is going to be in Mbale, and they've already identified the land, and something is being done about that. But at the same time, actually, the director mentioned that the biggest challenges they have is how are they going to treat people, because they need to train these people.
Yeah.
They need to have people working. Mm. So they need those doctors trained. They need radiologists. They need all this in place. Mm. So in as much as they want to do something fast, they also have to take into consideration the time it takes to train somebody who can operate a radiotherapy machine.
Mm.
They need to consider how long it takes a doctor to leave Makerere University, go and master in oncology, and how many are willing to go that direction. How are they going to pay for it? Mm. Is government going to pay for it? So all of these things is one of the reasons why things are going slowly.
Mm.
But yeah, something is being done.
I love that there's a long-term plan to it.
Yeah,
but maybe also, as you come in, Namudu, when we speak about breast cancer and you know, the whole idea of breast health, the one aspect that keeps coming back to me is the psychosocial support.
Absolutely.
How do we then, you know, have an intersection with helping people as they get treatment, before they get treatment, even post? Because there is that little bit of stigma. We are not really, it's not even little. It's big. There's a big stigma. There's a big fear when it comes to the word cancer, just even the word cancer alone.
Yeah.
So are there, you know, is there an intersection of mental health, psychosocial support, and breast cancer treatment?
Actually, that's what I wanted to discuss. I said with well-being, it's all psychological, mental, physical. So it's not only physical aspect about it. And that's why I said support system in mental health, it's important that support system is very proactive. She said there is still hope. That's also one way of reassuring a person, because with cancer, someone feels it's a death sentence. Give them hope to live each day.
Mm-hmm.
Even the whole process of chemo, especially at the end stage, it's a very vigorous process with so many changes that happen with the body, with the skin, and even hair. So there is need for the support system to keep on reassuring the person, reminding them for adherence of drugs, also supporting them to have a healthy diet as they take this medication. So the environment that these, that our friends, our brother, our sisters, our mothers are in is very important to help them go through this process of breast cancer prevention and also treatment.
Before we go for the break, I wanted to ask one thing. Is it possible that I can eat, and not to make it any way that if I wasn't on treatment and I wasn't a patient, but I know the diet a cancer patient that is on treatment is eating, and I choose, I'm like, you know what, Gulu, this is the food we should start eating now. Is it okay?
I think it should be okay.
Yeah,
it should be okay. That's already support system.
Our default choice should be the choice for what
healthy.
Is healthy. You know, that's the default choice that we should have. But also doctors have said, you know, sometimes it is difficult going through treatment.
Yeah.
You've had radiotherapy, maybe you have all these wounds here, you can't swallow.
Yeah.
And they say, if it is the ice cream that will give you the strength,
please have it.
Yeah, just have the enough strength to go through the treatment.
Yeah.
But our default choice should be a healthy diet.
Yeah.
A healthy diet as much as possible.
Let's take a break.
Okay.
And we'll be back. And when we come back, I want us to talk about, you know, what lifestyle changes can we then have, you know, to keep moving forward, including diet. And then what other interventions or activities are the different organizations doing during this month? Don't go away.
Digital rights are those human rights and legal rights that allow individuals to access, use, create, and publish digital media or to access and use computers, other electronic devices, and telecommunication networks. Digital rights include a right to freedom of expression, information, and communication through technology, a right to privacy and data protection, a right to credit for personal works, a right to universal and equal digital access, a right to identity, a right to anonymity, a right to be forgotten, and a right for protection of minors, among others. The state's digital rights are frequently violated through various unfair actions, for example, blockage of websites and social networks, theft of credentials, unauthorized use of people's data for personal gain, privacy intrusion, online censorship, arrests and intimidation of online users, internet blockages, and a proliferation of laws and regulations that undermine the potential of technology to drive social, economic, and political development worldwide. It is hence every citizen's responsibility to respect rights of other digital users and to speak out or report to the responsible parties when one's rights are violated.
Welcome back to this conversation. We are still talking about breast cancer, and we are raising awareness in this October month of breast cancer awareness. But then also, we want you to subscribe, continue with these conversations in your spaces so that you do not forget, you know, to tell someone about breast cancer and help them understand what they can do. Before we left, we were talking about lifestyle and mental health and all those things. On an individual basis, that's where the first responsibility stands, because you've got to be proactive with yourself. You've got to be checking on yourself, checking with your body. And I was imagining, then what can I do in lifestyle change even before I get the diagnosis, or even before I find out that maybe I'm struggling with breast cancer? What lifestyle changes can you do? We'll begin there.
Thank you very much, Gloria, for that. There are so many. As a human being, we should maintain a healthy diet. Besides cancer, there are also other diseases. Yeah. But if you maintain a healthy diet that is not compulsory, it should be part of you. That's part of proactiveness. Know that you have to eat your vegetables, you have to eat your fruits, drink a lot of water. Mm-hmm. It's not something that is forced because of a condition. That will help you boost your immunity to fight off any other condition that is there, and also have a fighting chance when you get cancer. So it's not something that you should do on a one-off. When people tell you, when you gym, when the weight, the scale tells you that you're overweight, then you start getting onto. No, it should be something that is consistent. That's the only way it can work, to have a healthy diet. But also in terms of wellness, I know as a certain class of people who are in corporates, they have medical insurance, which is about 1% of the Ugandan population. And medical insurance has offered wellness checks for most of their beneficiaries. And most of them don't actually use it.
Oh, wow.
It's a check that you don't have to be sick. I encourage people, use your birthday, use your anniversary. Go and check yourself. And some of these cancer screening tests are covered under these wellness checks.
Nice.
We have prostate, we have cervical, we have breast, all covered free of charge on your medical insurance. Take advantage of it and get to know what is going on with your body. Let's not wait until the last minute to check on our bodies, especially for the men. They have the tendency to, the ego, they're like, no, I can get through it. Let me get a painkiller. And by the time they are diagnosed, they are in their late stages, majorly for men, because they are always seem to be busy. And by the time they are diagnosed, it's already too late. So let's be proactive. Go out, do the checks. Don't wait until you are down. We need you productive, we need you healthy to be able to see your great-grandchildren.
Yes. And then let me come to Dr. Catherine, especially because you spoke about the sedentary lifestyle that we have. I mean, I wake up, I get in my car, I drive, sit, get
the
up,
computer.
Get in my car, go home, sit, watch TV, get in my bed, sleep. What does that got to do with our health, especially when we talk about things like breast cancer?
Yeah, a lifestyle where you're not exercising your body is a very, very dangerous lifestyle, basically, for well-being generally. You know, they tell you exercise has a lot of benefit for us. Like you've said, I've seen people in offices, someone is moving from second floor to third floor and they're taking the lift. You know, there are those small things we can do. Even picking up your phone and calling the person in the next office rather than just walking there. So there are those small things we can do, however busy we are, to just make sure every few minutes you're up on your feet. Yeah? Yeah, it's very, very important. It helps, first of all, even to help your mental agility. People who do exercise are more alert mentally. You help your brain health. It helps to reduce inflammation within the body. And inflammation is a condition that really, really supports cancer cells. It gives them life. So exercising, women even tell you, people who are going through, you know, hot flashes from hormonal therapy treatments and even, what is it called? Menopause, exactly. When they exercise, they reduce that. It's like you release all those, exactly. So it's very, very important that we exercise. And many times when we say exercise, people think, you know, you have to run a marathon, you have to go to the gym. Walk, do brisk walking, dance. Me, I like to dance. So in the morning, if it's raining, I will put my lingala there and dance. Make yourself active, make yourself, you know, happy. Walk, stretch, do yoga, things like that. Do housework. These days, we don't even bend anymore to mop the floor, to wash dishes. All those kinds of things are important for us. So it's really an appeal to all of us. We need to do this. We need to be more active. Much as possible. And not just for, I'm sure the doctors will say, even I think we're having an increase in blood clots.
Yes.
Blood clots are becoming a big problem. And
dying.
So we need to move much more to help ourselves to avoid all these problems.
I'm actually intrigued because that's something I've been reading about. My mom died of a pulmonary embolism. And it's not that it wasn't known to her, but that you fall one day and then you start to know, my leg hurts. But I hear you when you say to walk, because we've reduced on our walking. There is a boda somewhere that will take you. If the boda doesn't take you, there is a taxi that will pick you next to your home. So if we can increase how much we walk, and I'm guilty for saying the roads are not safe to walk, but do housework. Do housework. At least you've disqualified my excuse.
Or maybe you could also get an accountability partner. Like someone who's always following up on you. Say, come, let's walk this distance. Let's go and do this. Let's go. It helps you. It motivates you. Because people, sometimes the self-motivation comes, should I say slowly, but when you have someone that you're accountable for or who keeps on following up on you, it's much easier in that process.
Let's talk home. Okay, please first come in before we go to hormones.
She talked about regular checkups.
Yeah.
And it's really, really important because, you know, with cancer, by the time you feel pain, it's in late stages. And it could be that you have been moving with it for years, even 10 years. It's there, stage one.
Wow.
Moving slowly. 5 years later, two. Another 3 years, it's stage three. So if you are a person
who
does...
That's an aha moment for me.
If you're someone who does regular checkups, you're most likely to catch it before it goes there. Or catch it before it goes cancerous. And then to talk about also lifestyle. Alcohol is also associated with breast cancer. How much do you consume?
What kind of alcohol? They will ask.
Alcohol, anything alcoholic. If you can do beer, I'm told you shouldn't do more than one in a day. But you know, our men, this is Uganda. Every evening you are stopping over at the bar. After your with your beer, you're doing nyama choma, and then into your car. In your home, and then back into your car to work. So, what are you doing to yourself?
You've actually given me a aha moment.
Just to follow up, the fact that she said men, like, I'm not going to castigate them, like we are all guilty in some way. But when she said men, I felt that I need to emphasize that men also get breast cancer.
Yes.
And I have read a study that showed, I think it was in 2020 or 2018, at UCI, they did a survey of 500 patients and male breast cancer was 7%. Wow. Do you know what the global average of male breast cancer is? 1%.
Wow, that's a large number.
So if we look at this discrepancy, how come we have men overrepresented in, even though the sample is small, how come we have men overrepresented for 7% compared to a global average of 1%? Yeah. We as a country should be worried. Yeah. We should be worried. And I think we need to start also shouting much, much more about breast cancer for in men as
perhaps
well.
Perhaps even the policies and legislation yes. would be nicer if they actually know.
And it is one of the cancers yeah. that is on the rise. There are those cancers that are caused by infections. The doctors know you are exposed to some kind of virus. Mm. Apart from the cervical cancer, which has that exposure to the human papilloma virus, it's the only cancer in that category that is on the rise. But the others that were associated with HIV are reducing.
Oh, wow.
Now, breast cancer is on the rise. Cervical cancer is on the rise. But those other cancers are reducing. So it's important that we also, like, go out and, you know, try to read. Try to find information. Mm-hmm. Because I'm told 80% of liver cancers are attributed to hepatitis B virus. Mm-hmm. There is a vaccine against that.
There is.
Yeah. There is a vaccine against the human papilloma HPV, virus that yeah. exposes us to cervical mm. cancer. Mm. But so we need also a lot of advocacy in terms of encouraging people to go for uptake of these vaccines, because there is also a lot.
How do you deal with anti-vaxxers?
Aha. So those are all like challenges.
And there's so many.
And I was reading, by the way, you know that the cervical cancer vaccine, the HPV vaccine is. It's recommended to give it to young girls who have not yet had their first sexual debut. Yes. But even you who is already active, if they do a pap smear and find you're not exposed to the virus, you can take it. But I've read that in the developed countries, they are even now giving it to young boys. Just girls, they are now giving it to young boys. It has a lot of benefit. It I'm told for like 60% of neck cancers, head cancers can also be prevented by that vaccine.
Wow.
Yes. So it's important, penile cancer and all those things. So even men should start kujumbiraring this thing.
Yes.
Eh? Yes. So it's very, very important that we talk about vaccination as well, because that also reduces the general burden of cancer. You know, when somebody is afraid of breast cancer, it is not just because they know people who have died of breast cancer. It's because they know people who have died of cancer.
Yes.
As long as it's called cancer
they
will be scared. People will be scared. Mm. And yet even our statistics show, as much as like breast cancer is like number two among women, but in terms of killing people, it's number six.
Wow.
So if we can reduce deaths from any kind of cancer, it gives confidence that cancer can be curable, can be survived, and it improves behavior, health-seeking behavior for any kind of cancer.
Yeah.
So that is very important.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. I wanted Dr. Namatovu to come in, but also as you deal with that, help us understand what do the hormones have to do with this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There is research that shows that the menstrual hormones are actually related to breast cancer. It shows that if a girl has had her PCOS early enough, like below 12 years, that means this girl will be exposed to those menstrual hormones for a long period of time. Mm. So that particular girl has a higher risk of breast cancer.
Mm.
And also for a lady who has had menopause after a long period of time, like after 55 years, this particular woman has a higher chance of getting breast cancer. Mm. So it also shows that if a person has ever given birth, if you give birth, you always like get relieved from menstruation.
Mm.
So it means that that person has
less menstrual
less menstrual hormones, hence has lesser chance of getting breast cancer. So there is a relationship between the menstrual hormones and breast cancer.
On behalf of all the other women, what happens if I begin giving birth, like cyclic? Because that is what is then going to happen. That because I can reduce on the times I am having my menstrual cycles, I will give birth until I reach a point. I'm like, okay, if it's to kill me, it shall kill me.
Like a rabbit.
Yeah. How do you have that dynamic then not happen?
Okay. Oh, you know, these things are like, we do not know the actual cause of cancer.
Yeah.
So everything is just research being carried out, research being carried out. So if we can at least do avoid the risk factors and then have at least a baby, because also there is a relationship between the some oral contraceptives, still the hormones, breast cancer. So at least if we can have a child for a lady and then avoid all other risk factors, also to add on the health, the lifestyle changes.
Yeah.
We cannot forget smoking. Smoking is also a risk factor.
And it's even written there. So if you're smoking, you even...
Yeah.
The disclaimer is on the card.
Yes, and then another thing is multiple sexual partners. This predisposes one to cervical, the HPV virus, and which leads to cervical cancer. And if you have a particular cancer, you're still at greater risk of another cancer.
Oh, wow.
So if you have
cervical... So I can have cervical cancer and still get breast cancer.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Mm-hmm.
So if we can do all that, we can fight off the breast cancer.
I'm going to ask you the hard one. How important is sucking the breast? Because you said have a child, then the child will suck. Does that help our female partners? I had a doctor on TV say it's important that they suck the breast. How important is it?
It's very important that they suck their breast, both the babies and the big babies.
Okay.
Yeah, I hope we all understand the big babies. So please, the big babies, utilize and suck, not only for this month, but throughout
the
year.
Months.
Yeah, throughout
gentlemen.
The year. Gentlemen.
You have a go at
how about when you're breastfeeding, like...
That's why
and we're going to
baby.
Have competition. Like, yeah, we have to be
clear. One who gives the big baby the other one gives
for
when they are
breastfeeding.
They shouldn't. They shouldn't.
They're breastfeeding. They shouldn't.
They shouldn't. No.
Yeah, I think so.
Because already the baby is suckling both breasts.
Yeah. Oh, interesting.
If the big baby insists, tell him to wait a bit.
Yeah. I just wanted to add on something I remembered when she was giving her submission, and that is to do with the... You know, she said women who get late menopause are at a higher chance. And we just need also to be clear that the way cancer used to present before as an illness of wealthy countries, as an illness of older people, it is no longer the case. We have a very huge burden in low and middle income countries and a very huge burden among young people.
Oh, wow.
So in this country, 30 to 40, I think our median age is like 42.
Mm-hmm.
In the developed countries, it is beyond 50.
Mm. Oh, wow.
So we are getting this breast cancer at a much younger age compared to other countries. And it's very, very important that young people, teenagers, alert and we are aware, and of course also like the affluence that is you know every day you see all these young people, we are eating all these affluence is one thing that is increasing our predisposition because it's changing our because it is changing our lifestyles and all that. So it's important to know that it's not very far from us just because we are young.
Yeah.
It's not. Many members of Uokaso will tell you they had cancer in late 20s, early 30s. Yeah, we were all below, most of us below 40.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very important. But also to say that we have members who have survived more than 20 years.
Yes.
So there are many older women right now in their 70s, in their 60s, who have survived breast cancer. It's one of the most curable cancers if caught early and treated comprehensively. So please early detection.
And I think that's a hope for us. Mm-hmm. But maybe to also check in and what other hope do we have when it comes to, you know, dealing with breast cancer. And maybe, Caroline, you'd be in a better position because you're in a transition of time, seeing yourself change from the beginning, the journey that you've walked from the beginning of a treatment to where you are now. Because I think these are the stories that need to be there, that it's treatable. People can go through the process, hard as it is, but you can actually go through the process and see it to its end, especially because for you now, you're seeing 7 years later, and then we have 20 years. Those hope stories, how do we bank on them?
Okay, the truth about cancer treatment right now in Uganda, I can recommend the Uganda Cancer Institute because that's where I get my treatment. Yeah. And at the Uganda Cancer Institute, I interact with very many patients.
Yeah.
Like I told you earlier, we have patients presenting with stage 4 cancer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they walk out of that place. Okay.
Alive.
Alive. Mm. Most of them are in remission and eventually cured. Mm. Yes, so currently as we speak, the Uganda Cancer Institute has very good treatment. The chemotherapy that we have right now is not what we had in 2018.
Mm-hmm.
Currently, the treatment is really good. And as you remember, Catherine, you talked about the new machine we have.
Yeah.
People have been leaving Uganda to go to Nairobi for that radiotherapy because they have that machine particularly. Yeah. It's called what?
There's the cobalt one, the old one, and then the linear accelerator.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the linear accelerator. Yeah. So now we have that as well. And then apart from that, you know, as research is conducted, it's Uganda Cancer Institute is called the Center for Research. Okay, they say research is their source. Yeah. So they're doing a lot of research and coupled with research and important. The treatments that they are able to give their patients, we are really getting very good outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I can confidently say that apart from just the few survivor stories that we have currently, there is much hope that we can beat cancer as long as we follow the treatment. So because one of the biggest challenges we have is we have patients being diverted to herbal treatments.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's true. And okay, herbal treatment, yes, I will say, I cannot really say for sure that I have met someone who said I was treated herbally and then I'm feeling cured. Most of the people that we meet, most of the patients, actually I have one patient whom I support currently. She went to a herbalist when she was diagnosed instead of Cancer Institute. She came back to Cancer Institute later in stage 4. Yet the cancer was caught at stage 1. Wow. Wasted time there. Mm. And right now she's struggling with chemotherapy and the doctors are hopeful, yes, but we cannot tell
the time that was lost.
It's hard.
Yeah. And when you say that, then I had that moment of, I know people who have prayed it.
Mm-hmm.
They prayed it out. And I think maybe it's also the construct of our society. They've prayed out the cancer. Mm-hmm. They've taken all kinds of herbal medicine only to worsen the situation. Mm-hmm. How do we, you know, create, even for the Ebola, let's not go very far.
Mm-hmm.
Even for Ebola, people have gone to the witch doctors to get help.
Yeah.
How do we have, you know, a connection of knowledge and awareness of it can be cured? If you found it early, please get the help that you need. How do we get that connection? I feel like there's a disconnect there.
Okay, the truth is there are a lot of myths surrounding cancer.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then also the kind of treatment for cancer is not an easy one.
I know.
Chemotherapy is not a treatment that you will get today and then walk out of it tomorrow, go to your workplace and you are okay.
I hear you.
And then cancer treatment, you are not going to go for 1 week like you go for malaria and then you're done.
Mm-hmm.
For breast cancer, it may take at least 1 year.
Yeah.
So all these things are contributors. The myth.
Mm.
And then also lack of correct information about cancer. And it's not just among the population. Even health workers themselves do not have the right information. Yes, if someone has not worked with oncology, with cancer itself,
they don't have the
most
right information.
Of our health workers out there cannot tell you anything about cancer.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
That's problematic because that's a gap.
It's a very big gap. Mm. That, okay, Uganda Cancer Institute is trying to reach out to government facilities. Mm. But remember, in Uganda, we tend to go to private most of the time.
Yes, yes.
And these private people are really not forthcoming about working with Cancer Institute to try to integrate this or train their workers and that. So, so there is that gap, and we have to accept that it's there, and it's going to take time to deal with it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, thank you for saying that, because it reminded me what Dr. Catherine said. The people that end up at your organization that didn't see through the medication, stopped somewhere, most probably couldn't afford it. But I also know there is a category of people who go, get the diagnosis, and decide they won't do anything about it.
Mm.
They're like, no, let it kill me. Then let me go through. Instead of going through, because I've seen a cancer patient go through the therapy, the treatment, and oh my God, between the wounds in the throat, the loss of hair, the loss of weight, the change of skin, there's so much pain. Yeah.
Let's also not forget to mention the mastectomy. If it's breast cancer, the breast has to go.
The breast has to go. Mm-hmm. So you're dealing with all these changes at the same time. And a person decides, no, it would rather kill me slowly. So I know it's within me, it's killing me, but I'm okay. I'm okay with it killing me.
I will mention something that I read. Somebody said that for most of the people, the fear of public speaking is greater than the fear of death.
Mm.
So to tell them to speak at a funeral, they would rather be in the coffin.
Mm.
And I want to just relate that to the same, the fear of a cancer diagnosis for many people is greater than the fear of the, you know, like what you have to go through to get fine, you know?
Mm.
And I think that is why advocacy, talking about these things, is very, very important. You know, when you sit with her, you sit with me, you sit with so many other people. I mean, if I didn't tell you, you would never know. But there's a point of my life when I could also not recognize myself.
Yeah.
And it is important that we know how much toll that treatment takes on somebody.
Yes.
Because I think there is a lot, when you talk to survivors, people tell you, like 50% of them lost jobs, 50% of them lost partners.
Mm.
So there is a lot of financial toxicity that people go through because of a cancer diagnosis. Mm. Even just eating healthy, these healthy foods are not cheap.
They're not cheap.
Yeah, but neither is treating cancer, you know? Yes. So there is so much that we are experiencing that is unspoken.
Yeah.
When we talk about these numbers, people see numbers, but you need to see the human beings behind these
numbers.
You need to ask, Catherine, where were you working before? What happened when you got ill? Did you have to leave a job or not? So that systemic empathy is very, very important, both in our public service is actually better in terms of systemic empathy than the private sector.
Oh, wow.
In private sector, very few organizations
the human will, person to
exactly they will just be counting like these are so many days of lack of productivity, and even after treatment and even being cured, the treatment doesn't leave you the same.
Yes,
there are many things you will not be able to do. You've had a mastectomy, you are going to go to a gym and try to stretch in a certain way, and it will remind you that, hey, excuse me.
You cannot do that.
Exactly,
anymore.
You can't do this anymore. Mm. You are not going to be able to carry certain things. Your bones, you're going to have to be maybe on calcium supplements all your life.
Mm.
There are certain long-term effects of that medication that you're going to have to face, and people don't know any of this.
Yeah.
You know, so you'll see that the productivity of certain workers may go down. It may not happen for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
But the systemic empathy that I'm calling for is to recognize that this person who was previously this very hard worker has had something that has changed the way they can cope.
Mm-hmm.
And so we should be empathetic.
Yeah.
And also remember, you know, it's it's them today. You know, Philip Bongole retire sang, yes, today it's me, tomorrow is someone else.
Mm-hmm.
It was the same for HIV.
Yeah.
And the statistics, at least like the US statistics, show 1 in 8 women will get breast cancer in her lifetime.
Wow.
So the Waganda say, this proverb, it starts with me, like,
Yes,
you know, now we talk about the ones who have had it, we stigmatize them, but tomorrow it might be us.
Yes.
So we have to ask, how are we preparing everybody for a situation where, if it is me, how would I want to be treated?
Mm.
If it is my sister, how would I want her to be treated? If it is my wife, if it is my mother, if it is my sister, if it is my husband, for the men, how would I want it to be treated?
Yeah.
So it's very important that we look at people's experiences as experiences of human beings who equally need love, respect, care, and support. And the best we can do is just check up, be there as much as you can. Sometimes, people don't realize how lonely this journey is. The fear, the anxiety. You go through, you know, emotions today, you're up there, tomorrow, today you are singing praises, I have overcome, tomorrow you're crying in depression.
Mm-hmm.
It's a roller coaster. You lose yourself. It takes time to even find yourself emotionally. You stand in the mirror, look at yourself. People used to say you are cute. Wrinkles have invaded you. The hair has fallen off. Your skin has become black. You're looking at yourself and you're like, is this really me? Yes. And so to just be there. To be there for patients, to be there at a personal level, if it is your friend, if it is your family member, if it is your employee, if it is, please, empathy. Mm-hmm. People will tell you they have been loved back to health.
Yeah.
Because people stood with them and told them, you can do this, you can beat this. When they are crying, when you're crying, they are hugging you, they are not judging you. Hey, but you think that crying is going to help you, you know? Exactly.
So, that's a frail person to be strong in that moment.
Yes. So I'm appealing, really, for empathy.
And then talking about that, the other thing we need to realize is that when someone is going through this treatment, you're not going to come with one basket of fruits today and stop there. It is constant.
Long term.
And the biggest challenge we've had is that people coming in at acute stage. Yes. Let's say you've just been diagnosed, everyone is there.
Then they disappear.
Or maybe you're going for surgery, everyone has come. They will flood with food. And at that time, you can't even eat. Then at the time when you really needed the food,
it's not there.
They're not around.
Yeah. Or Ubuntu.
We need to be there all through. And then please, if you can afford, give them counseling. Mm. If you can afford a psychologist, please.
And I was going to ask this because I don't know. I really find there's a big connect with mental health and cancer and cancer treatment. And in our family, we've taken care of a mental health person, and there's no end to it. Does that happen to cancer patients? Because you know, you're going through a year, and almost feels like we've been at this for a year. Do people get the fatigue of taking care of their patients? Does a patient get the fatigue of, you know, I've been at this medicine fatigue for a year? Because I know for a fact taking care of a mental health person was deteriorating even for us who were because there was no end to it. And while cancer might have a moment of end, do you come to a point where you be like, everyone is gone? Like, do they leave, like disappear for a while and then show up along the journey, or do some people stay a constant there?
Okay, what I know is there are those people who will be there all through. And these are people who might be there because they do not have a choice.
Yeah.
It could be a mother, it could be a daughter. Okay, your mom is sick, what can you do about it? And then there are those people who will come and go. and there's nothing you can do about it. You cannot dictate how people will react to the situation. Mm. Some people are just full of fear. But one thing I'm sure about taking care of a cancer patient is the person who does take care of someone might be sicker than the patient themselves.
Yes. Yeah.
And the doctors advise, please take turns. Oh, do not leave one person on a patient all through. Mm. They will get depressed.
Mm.
You see, for me, my daughter has been there all through. But now what I did was I let her go to boarding school because she needed that break. Yeah. I really could see she's depressed. Mm. It is affecting her. Mm.
Interesting.
Being there all through will leave an impact.
And so as much as we're getting treatment for the cancer, we need to also have mental and psychosocial support for the caretakers as well.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All right. Mm-hmm. Dr. Namatovu, help us understand remission. I know in a certain stage in breast cancer treatment or even in any other cancer, there is a point where we say the patient is in remission.
Mm.
What does that mean?
Okay, so in remission, a patient, like, how can I call it?
In the simpler term.
In simpler terms.
In simple terms. If the simple terms refuse, like I have survivors who know. So I will bank, but maybe let me bank on Dr. Catherine on
the simple terms.
At this point, the oncologist says you're in remission.
Yeah, that it means that they have checked and there is no presence of cancer. Now, from a survivor perspective, there are times you talk to people and say, I had cancer, I got cured. And people look at you like, who told her cancer can be cured?
Mm-hmm.
Because many people previously believed that you could only go in remission, but at point
alert,
it will come back, you know? Mm-hmm. Now, there is talk about cure. I even see the tweets of Uganda Cancer Institute saying cancer is curable.
Yes. Yes.
And I think that is also something we need to get out there.
Yes.
Because it also gives, you know, to live a life where all the time, it might come back, it's like you're looking at
a shadow.
Yes, you know. So, but basically, in simple terms, that is really what remission is about, that they are checked, they can see there is no presence of cancer cells anymore. But sometimes the medication hits it, and then maybe they cannot see it, but maybe it had spread somewhere, and then they find it had gone to another site and all that. It does happen.
Oh.
Yeah, but it can be, you can be found to not have, and it can come back, but you can also be found to not have. And you can stay so many years. I've told you, we have people who have lived over 20 years. They don't have any problem, and they also, their quality of life is good. They are not on medication. They are not in and out of hospital. So it is, I think, medical doctors need to kind of clarify and talk about these things more often so that we understand where do we fall now. Is it that those other countries can now talk about cure and for us we are not yet confident enough to talk about it? How does remission relate to cure and risk of reoccurrence and things like that? So I think there's so much, really so much research that needs to be done and so much information to be gotten out there, but also to appeal to them. They don't know how to say things to common people. They know that medical language.
My ideology of remission was, please be in waiting.
No.
Yeah. Because someone tells you, I'm in remission, and you're still worried for them. You're like, should I say congratulations? Should I say, are you worried?
You should say congratulations.
Oh, interesting.
Okay, for me, the way I understand remission is for breast cancer, you've gone through the major treatments, that is chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and surgery. And then maybe now you're on maintenance treatment for 3 years because they've seen there is no cancer present, so they put you on that maintenance. At least you may be on maintenance for maybe 3, some people 5 years.
Mm.
And then after those years, if they again check and nothing is seen, they can declare you free.
Can they say at that point that have been cured?
Mm-hmm. Yes, mm-hmm. But
quite long term.
One of the things we shouldn't leave out is that the mere fact that you've suffered from cancer is also a risk factor for suffering from another
cancer. Yes. To cancer. Yeah.
Yes, so that's why they will always, okay, as long as you've ever gone through cancer treatment, you will always have to go back for checkups every year.
Oh, wow. That's very important to know. Because in my imagination would be that it's almost like how I wake up and have this terminal illness and then I'm okay, then I am done. Mm-hmm. So that means you need to keep going. Mm-hmm. Keep checking.
Always go back.
Oh, wow. That's quite interesting. Mm-hmm. But maybe as we wind down this conversation, what one thing would you want people to take away from this conversation? If they forget everything else we've talked about, that mm-hmm. one thing you want someone to remind themselves on a constant. I'll begin with you and then end with Caroline at the end.
Thank you very much. I love the conversation that we're having.
Yeah.
The one thing I would emphasize is definitely the support system.
Yeah.
Be the person that someone can rely on. Don't just be a one-off person. Mm. Put yourself, be empathetic. Put yourself in that person's shoes.
Yeah.
Because as you've seen the statistics, those at the Cancer Institute would prefer a survivor because they feel they are more empathetic. Mm. But they have brothers, they have sisters, they have mothers. So be that support system, because we now have learned that cancer is actually curable.
It is curable.
So be there throughout the stages and be part of their journey as they go through this stage, like what you would want others to be for you.
Thank you.
I think that's a major thing for me that I've picked
support
out.
Support system. Yes. Thank you. Dr. Namatov.
Okay. One thing I want to emphasize is a self-examination.
Yeah.
You can actually just
For the men who don't know, because the men don't know that they can self-examine also.
Okay, so we are going to just use the look and feel. Yeah.
Mm.
Stand in front of the mirror.
Mm.
Hold your hips.
Mm-hmm.
Look. What are we looking for? We are looking for the signs. Is there any discharge? Is there any change in the skin? Like the dimpling, the wrinkling? Is there any change in size of the breast? Like particularly any abnormality?
Mm.
After that, we are now going to raise your hands slowly up to the head.
Mm.
What are we looking at here? We are looking at the speed at which these breasts are ascending.
Mm. Mm.
So one with a mass will not be ascending at the same speed with the one which has no mass. Mm. So do the same while removing the hands from up to down. Now that we are done with the looking, the next thing is we are going to feel, or what we call palpation in the medical term. So we are feeling for any mass and then press for any discharge.
Mm.
If it's a breastfeeding mother, automatically it will be a breast milk.
Mm.
But for a normal person who is not breastfeeding, we do not expect any discharge.
Mm.
So this discharge can be creamy or blood.
Mm.
So you first press the nipple for any discharge. After that, you're going to feel. You can do it in a circular motion.
Mm.
The breast tissue starts from the below the collarbone.
Oh.
So you are going to feel.
Up.
Yes, not just here.
Mm.
So you are going to feel this whole part, including the armpit.
Mm.
So all that.
I didn't know that.
Do it in a circular way, slowly, slowly. In case of any mass, you'll be able to feel it.
Yeah.
So you're doing it while standing up, and then do it while lying down, putting this.
Oh,
if it's if you're checking the left breast, put the left hand behind, then palpate.
Oh,
slowly, slowly, slowly. Then do it for the other breast.
Other breast as well.
So in case you find anything, that's when you can seek for further medical attention.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah, mine is. Follow up from hers, because the problem I think has not been that people haven't seen these masses or haven't had suspicious things in their breasts. The problem is that they have seen them, they have had them and kept quiet and waited until they have started feeling pain or hoping that they will disappear. So my point is taking on from hers, please. If you suspect anything, if you find any abnormality, go to a health center and do the tests that are required to see whether it's a cancer or not. Why? Because it is survivable. Yeah. It is survivable. Early detection and early treatment save lives. So please, we all fear. I can't say don't fear.
Yeah.
Even me, I feared. Hey, even me, I feared. But
here you are.
Yeah, but I mean, it is there. It has come. We need to face it, and we can only be victorious over it if we face it before its fangs are really out. So please, don't hesitate. Don't sit back with an abnormality in your breast. And not every abnormality is a cancer.
Yes.
So there's no need to just fear and conclude. Eh?
It is
for cancer. Yourself, it is cancer. I'm going to die and all that, you know. Yeah. So yeah, that's my take-home message.
That's very important.
Caroline.
Yeah, for me, I would like to tell everyone, please, seek help from the right place. Let's not waste time trying to cut shortcuts, because those shortcuts are not going to help. Treatment might be difficult, it might be traumatizing, whatever, but let's go to the right place. Go to the Uganda Cancer Institute. You will get the help you need. You will get the treatment you will need. And if you need support, please ask. Okaso is there. We will support you through your treatment. Even if you just need someone to listen.
Yeah.
Whether it is at midnight and you call me and you are patient, I will listen to you. Because myself, I'm a patient and I know what it means to have someone willing to listen to you.
Yeah.
And people out there, please do not treat somebody who has cancer like they are dead. We are not dead. We are living. I am here. I can still come here and help someone.
Yeah. Yeah.
Having cancer does not mean that my life has ended. And do not treat me like one who is already walking to her grave. Let's treat them with respect. Let's remember that cancer does not choose. If anybody can get cancer.
True.
Even you who is treating that person that way today, you might be the next one tomorrow.
True.
That's what I was looking
for. Even if it's not you, it might be your relative, someone you love. So please, let's be kind and give any support you can.
Yeah.
It's very important. These people need support, not abandonment.
Yeah. That's important. Maybe to remind people, Dr. Thurin, as you come in, to also remind people that the activities you're doing during, there will be people who will join this conversation as it's winding down, the activities you're doing for this month and how they can join, and then also Rocket Health can tell us, and then we close down the conversation.
Okay. Yeah, this month, the Uganda Women's Cancer Support Organization is raising awareness in corporate institutions, churches, family groups, about breast cancer. We are going to ministries, to banks, to private sector organizations. Anyone who invites us, we are really trying to manage and make sure we are there to raise this awareness. And I already at the beginning mentioned that ultimately, to crown it all, this awareness month, we are going to have a public dance workout at the MTN Arena in Lugogo on the 4th of November, 6 p.m. And we are bringing screening services there as well, free screening services. So we encourage everybody to really come. We are going to release the flyer and the promotional video, but participation is 20,000. We will give all the information on these flyers and all that, how you can pay the 20,000 and get the kit that will permit you to participate. And but I wanted also to just mention that on a day-to-day basis, every day, the Uganda Women's Cancer Support Organization works with patients. And so we've been to these corporate institutions and people are saying, we wish we knew you were there. We used to leave our mother at home depressed. We didn't know that there are people who can counsel. So please know that we have these counseling services. We are not where we would like to be in terms of financing and all, but all these survivors are willing to give as much as they possibly can. But the help that some patients need is not just counseling. I told you already about people who have no food. Every day, at least five people come to our offices at the Catholic Church in Kamocha, asking for food, asking for accommodation. And sometimes we go to homes, someone, you get an SOS, go to a home to counsel somebody, and you leave even more depressed than when you went, because you've counseled her, but you can see she has no food
to eat.
And then so a lot of our survivors, even while trying to show courage and use our scars to help out other people, are dropping out of this counseling program because they too are, they too are traumatized by. So the situation is not good for everybody, and we need help. If people who can donate foodstuffs, you know, sugar, flour, dry beans, those things that we can, you know, give people
when you go to visit.
Yes, yeah. And for a day-to-day thing, we welcome that a lot at the Uganda Women's Cancer Support Organization, but also offer, please reach out to us if you feel anybody needs counseling. We are there, and we will do as much as we can to help out.
Thank you very much. And finally, Rocket Health, what are you doing?
Thank you very much. On behalf of Rocket Health, we're working together with different organizations, in addition to what OSA is doing, to ensure that we bring the awareness to people. People hear about breast cancer, but they don't know the nitty-gritties about it.
Yes.
We've also made the services affordable and accessible to people. We can do these tests in the comfort of your home. All they need to do is just dial 280#, and they will be able to talk to a doctor, and we're able to send people to come and do some of these tests from the comfort of their homes. Of course, apart from the X-ray tests that need to be done physically. But we are still continuously doing women wellness checks. We're celebrating the women. We're not only doing breast cancer. As you've known, you're preceptive to other cancers. So we're doing also reproductive health tests such as syphilis, HIV, blood grouping. It's necessary for someone to know that, especially when there's blood transfusion. It's necessary for people to know their blood grouping. So we're bringing these services up, and we have packages ranging from 70,000 to 140,000. Do it for your sister, do it for your mother, do it for your cousin. There are people who are able to do this. It's not only the women who do it, but the men. You have a sister, you have a cousin. Even the men are subjective to this. Take charge and do the tests. It's better preventive than curative.
Thank you, ladies. It was a very wonderful, actually a very eye-opening conversation to have. You take something away from it. You also learn something new. And also thank you, and I wish you well on your journey to recovery. I'm more positive now that you've beaten the harder bits of it. So I'm wishing you well, Caroline. And I am glad to meet survivors, because at least you know it's not doom, like a lot of people think. So thank you for joining us for this conversation. The Breast Cancer Awareness Month goes until 31st October. But I caution you to continue these conversations. Please don't stop on October. Talk to your family members. Go for these checkups. Make it fun. Go as a family for a health checkup. You know, indulge yourselves. Do the self-examination. Push for a good lifestyle and be proactive with your health. Thank you for joining us. I've been your host, Tricia Gloria Navaye. Bye for now.